let you know that Lock In 2012, Carson Newman, is March 23rd. That's coming up probably in 3 weeks. Fifth and sixth grade are going if you want to go. So you need to get signed up. Tell Miss Rachel to start a sign-up sheet and get that to me. Okay, Noah? Tell Miss Rachel, she's back in your room, to get a sign-up sheet, shirt size, names on it, and get it to me, okay? All right, listen to me. I have to have these in about a week and a half to get shirts ordered, okay? For $12, that's what it costs to go to the lock-in. That's going to be on Friday, March 23rd, and that'll be registration. Will be from like 6 o'clock to 7:30, and then we'll leave here at 8 o'clock, okay? Listen, we're doing a T-shirt, pizza, and all-night fun, and for $12. So be sure and get on the list tonight. I'm going to be have it with somebody back here in the back. Amy, where's she at? I don't know where she went off to. But I'll have it back there where you can get signed up and get those in. Again, here in about a week and a half, I'm going to be ordering shirts. So there you go. That's sign up for the walk. Okay. All right. Now, that's all the announcements I have. We're going to ask Josh to come here in just a minute, and I'm going to open this up in prayer. And tonight's a little unusual of a service, okay? Tonight we're going to be doing something, a testimony service. You've seen the candles and stuff up here, and we're going to be doing a little different. I'll explain here when we get done. So I know some of you are sitting there. You're nervous. Rex, don't worry about it. It's no pressure. No pressure whatsoever, okay? So I'm going to ask Josh to come on up. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for this night you've given us. God, I pray that you would just have your way here tonight. I pray that we can realize how real salvation is. God, I pray that as we reflect tonight on our salvation and what you've done in our lives, I pray that you would just speak to our hearts. And I pray that all the work that you've done on the cross and how you defeated death and how you arose, how you laid it all out for us, I pray tonight that that would become real to us. I pray that that would become real in our hearts. And just allow us tonight to share your life. We want you to have all the glory. We want you to have all honor. We exalt you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Before we get started, I don't know if you guys knew this, but Stephanie had her wisdom teeth taken out. She's still out. Keep her in prayers. She's healing. She said, I seen on Twitter the other day, she said that she looked like she'd been beat up or hit with the uppercut or whatever. So I'd say she looks pretty bad. So just pray for her that she gets better and she can be back up here with you guys leading worship. So as we go into worship time tonight and as we get ready to go in this testimony time, let's just pray as a group that God connects with us tonight, that His Spirit connects with us tonight as we worship Him. And as some of you bring your testimonies and those that are planned and those that are unplanned, I pray tonight that the Holy Spirit guides your words and that you're in the back and He's up front and your words are spoke to reach others in this place tonight. So as we worship, let's just tell God how great He is through this song. You're familiar with this song. It's a Chris Tomlin tune, which is great. But it's called How Great Is Our God. So let's sing this together, okay? And lift up your voices tonight.
Sing with me, how great.
God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, we'll see how great is our God. Amen. Give our Lord a hand tonight. He's great. Amen. When I was praying about the songs that I need to do, and I thought about tonight as we come and we have candlelight and we have testimonies, and one verse in my mind, God put it there, I'm pretty sure, but one verse left out at me in my mind tonight as I was thinking about some songs, and this is the line. It says, "Light of the world, you step down in the darkness." As we come tonight, as we light this candle over here, Jesus Christ, the light of the world, he stepped down into this darkness for us. And as we come tonight, as you give your testimonies, as you share from your heart, let me tell you guys, a preacher can get up and preach till he's blue in the face. But you can reach people just by giving your testimony, letting them see how God has moved in your life and how he's changed your life and how he's done great things in your life. So I am so thankful that you're going to give your testimonies tonight. So as we sing this song, it's called "Here I Am to Worship." And tonight as we come, we are here to worship our Savior. Amen. Through the songs and through the words that you guys are going to speak tonight. So let's sing this together, okay? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you, Father, as you are the light that leads us. You're the light into our path, Father. We pray tonight as these testimonies are spoken, Father, as we have worshiped you in song, Father, we pray that your Spirit comes down and it visits with us tonight, that you move in a mighty way, Father, as our people and your people share their hearts tonight. Lord, how you've worked in their lives, Father, how you have made their faith true, their faith in you, Father, you've showed in each one of us, Father. If we have faith, you will be there and you will answer. And Father, we thank you for guiding us and walking with us each step of the way, leading us in the way that you want us to be led. Father, we thank you for that. And I thank you so much for your Spirit tonight, Lord. Let your Spirit be in the hearts of your people. In Jesus' name we pray.
Two weeks ago, we talked about relationship with the lost. You can be seated. Two weeks ago, we finished up our relationship with the lost series. And the last week, we talked about our relationship with the lost. We talked about, number one, we talked about relationship with God. First and foremost, our relationship with Christ has to be at a point where we don't care to let people know that we love Christ, okay? Now, listen here. Rule number one, when God's word's open, let's listen, okay? It's not about me, not because I like orange and blue, not because my toenails are long, but because Jesus needs respect. All right? All right. All right. All right? All right. Now, I want to share with you, the relationship series was talking about our relationship with God, and it's where boldness comes in, and we have to get our relationship right with him so that we don't care. Listen, it all boils down to a time and a place where we choose to share Christ, okay? And I know that God has dealt with some of you, maybe this past 2 weeks, maybe God's give you this time to prepare yourself, I don't know. Maybe God hadn't said anything. Maybe you've not thought anything else about it. But I'm going to be honest with you. I want to read some scripture to you. In Mark 16, verses 15 and 16, it says, "And he said to them," now the he is capitalized, the H is capitalized, and this is Jesus speaking, okay? He said in Mark 16, verse 15, "And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." And you just went, whew, thank goodness. He said to preach. I don't have to do that. Hold on a minute. "He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned." Now let me take this a step further. Let me get you off the hook, okay? I want to share with you that so many people that have come to know Jesus Christ have took this scripture, and when he says to go to all nations and preach the gospel, we say, man, we don't have to do that. I'm not called to do that, and we don't have to do that because I'm not a preacher, okay? Now, I'm going to be honest. Even over in Matthew, it says we're commanded to go into all nations, and it's no question. We got to leave Church Hill. We've got to go to different places, and it's not a suggestion. But I want you to start here. I want you to be comfortable here. It's why we do Mission Possible. I want you to learn how to do mission work. I want you to learn how to share Christ from your heart. Okay? Now I'm going to be honest with you. You're not preachers, maybe, and some of you in this room could be. Who knows? Through your obedience, through your faith, through your growth, God will call you. Pastor Derek, probably at age 9, 10, 11, didn't plan on being a pastor. Okay. To be totally honest with you, at age 15, 16, 17, and 18, I never planned on being a pastor. But some 20 years later, God calls. But I've often wondered if I would have stepped up to the plate when I accepted Christ as my Savior and got familiar with Him and built relationship with Him and shared. Listen, you don't have to be preachers. He says to go to all nations. He says to go and make disciples. You are commanded to share the gospel, the good news. You're commanded to share what Christ has done in your heart. And I'm going to tell you something. That's what's going to lead people to Jesus Christ. Is there some of you here there's some of you here, and I'm talking about a relationship that's real with Jesus Christ. I'm talking about your relationship with Christ is what's going to lead other people to Christ. I can preach. It's like Josh said, I can stand here and preach and preach and preach and preach, and it doesn't matter. But when you make a decision, when you make a choice to share Christ from your heart, what he's done in your life, it's going to make a difference. Now, there's some of you that says you're a born-again believer, and here's what may be the thing. You may have went through a prayer. You may have come to Bible school and attended all week and got a certificate and thought you was a good person and saved or whatever. I want to tell you something. Salvation. Salvation is more than prayer. Okay? It's a free gift. Let me tell you what salvation is. Not only it's a free gift and it's eternity with Christ, let me tell you, it's so much more. Salvation. Salvation is the Holy Spirit walks with you. Salvation is the Holy Spirit giving you comfort. Salvation is Christ says in his word, he'll never leave you or forsake you. Salvation is I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Salvation is for nothing's impossible with God. I do this right here. I do this. You know why? Because I done it when I was your age. I was sharing with Taylor Patterson a week or so ago. Her dad and myself were at a retreat together. And I was sitting in a room about like this. And the youth pastor lit a candle. And he shared the story. And I want to share with you this big candle. And what this is representation, okay? This big candle represents Jesus. Man, I want you to know that Jesus started and he came to earth as human and he surrounded himself with 12 guys. Okay? And I put 12 candles out here. Let me shut this door. I don't want any distractions. But I put 12 candles out here because Jesus started his ministry. Jesus started his ministry with 12 disciples. And man, he poured everything he had into these 12. You know why? He didn't want them to think, I want you to see all the miracles. See everything I've done. I want you to get it all. That wasn't the purpose. His purpose was he poured everything into those disciples because he loved them so that they could go into all nations and share what he meant to their heart. So, here's what this represents. The big candle stands for Jesus. I've put 12 around it. We can take even one of them away. He was Judas and he betrayed Christ and he never shared his faith. He never had faith. They says, you know, the Bible it said he was taken away, was lost from the disciples, from the fold, but Jesus still loved him. So here's the thing. Are you one of the 11? Are you one of the 11 that's willing to say, you know what, Christ, you died for me, and I'm willing to share what you've done for me in my life? And again, I'll tell you that testimonies are not about your sick grandparents or about a flat tire on your car. It has nothing to do with that. But a testimony is what Christ did in your life when you accepted Jesus Christ and what he's doing today in your life. Okay, we're going to start. I said a few minutes ago, what's going to make people come to know Jesus Christ is hearing you share your faith. I'm going to go a step further than telling you that. I'd like to introduce our pastor's wife, Miss Missy Bell. I'd like to ask her to come up, and she's going to share her testimony. I'm going to turn the lights. Can you see the read by candle? Okay. I'm going to hit these lights, and she's going to start it off, okay?
Let me be honest and say, it's hot up here. It's hot out there. I am nervous as a cat in a room full of rocking chairs. So, this is not my comfort zone at all. I usually teach first through fourth grade boys upstairs, and you'd think I could handle anything if I could handle that. But tonight I'm talking to some teenagers, so and I tried to come up with a good joke to make me not so nervous, but I'm not a good joke teller, so we'll move on from that. But I went to my good friend Wikipedia and I put in the word testimony, and Wikipedia is a lot smarter than I am, so this is what Wikipedia said that a testimony is. A solemn attestation to the truth of a matter. Well, what's that? For a Christian, testimony is simply telling your story in your words of what God did for you, how God changed your life, how you became a Christian. That's your testimony. If you're saved, you have one. Period. But for most of us, that's not an easy thing to do. I don't like standing in front of people. God and I have this agreement that as long as he doesn't ask me to stand in front of people, he and I are okay. When he asks me to do something like this, it's outside my comfort zone, and he and I have words. So we've had many words about this because this is not where I'm comfortable. But Mitch asked me to do this. He asked me to do it by video. And I said, well, why don't I just do it in person? I wish I'd done it by video, because I could hit fast forward and be done. Anyway, just bear with me. And why that's hard for a lot of us to give our testimony, I don't know. There are many reasons. A lot of us are shy. I was very shy, used to be very shy. I have got over that a lot by being a pastor's wife. But a lot of us are really shy. Some of us are afraid of what our friends are going to say about us, or they're going to think about us if we share Jesus. Some of us think we don't have a testimony, and you may not. If you don't have a testimony, you're not saved, and we can handle that tonight. We can take care of that. We can give you a testimony. So, and some of us think that there's nobody that wants to hear it. Nobody wants to hear what I have to say, but let me tell you, there is somebody that needs to hear what you have to say. Let me share something with you. When I was a teenager, when I was in high school, I started asking questions like all teenagers do. Why? And I was confused about a lot of things in life. I wanted the answers to life, and I wasn't getting them. Not the answers that I wanted. So I started searching for something. I was missing something in my life, but I wasn't sure what it was. I was going to church every time the doors were open because Mom and Daddy said to. Many of you are there too. You're here because Mom and Daddy said to. I was the same way. I was involved in my youth group. We were a very small group, but we were very close. I was very involved, but something was not right. I wasn't getting it. I wasn't feeling it. So I started looking, started searching for the answers. What was I missing? I wasn't seeing it. So as a junior in high school, I was 17, and I started looking into colleges. Dad wanted me to go to a good Christian college, of course. I just wanted to go somewhere away from home because I needed to get away from Mom and Daddy's thumb, and I needed to change. I needed to find the answers to life, and I thought I could do that better by myself, away from Mom and Daddy, away from my family, away from my friends. I needed something different. So I visited Southeastern Free Will Baptist Bible College, a little Christian college like Mom and Daddy wanted me to. In Virginia Beach, Virginia. Yay! Way away from Morristown, Tennessee. So while I was there, I attended a testimony service, much like this one right here. An 18-year-old freshman in college named Rhonda Radford stood up to give her testimony. From the first word out of her mouth to the last word out of her mouth, I sat spellbound. I thought, I have never met this girl. She knows me, and she knows everything I've done and everything I've been through and everything I've felt the last year, because everything out of her mouth was me. It was exactly what I had been through that year. All of my questions, everything was it was exactly what she said. And I thought, okay, who's told her? Who's told on me? Who's told her? You know, God has a funny way of working. God has a sense of humor. If you think he doesn't, look around at some of your friends. He does. So God used this girl and her testimony. And while she was speaking, I realized what it was that I was missing. It was Jesus. I had never given my heart and my life to him. I had been playing a game. I knew exactly how to talk like a Christian, I knew how to walk like a Christian. I knew how to act like the perfect little Christian girl, because that's what I'd been doing for years. But as I was listening to Rhonda, I realized I had never met Jesus personally. I had never given him my heart, and he certainly didn't have my life. That was mine. So I gave in to him. I said, God, I'm yours. I'm yours. From that day forward, I found what it was that I was missing. He completed me. Because of that teenager that later became one of my very dearest friends, because I did go to that college, because she gave her testimony that night, because she wasn't afraid, she wasn't ashamed of what somebody would think about her, she wasn't too shy to tell it, because of her standing up and giving her testimony, my life changed forever. I met my Savior that night because of Rhonda Radford. And all she did was get up and tell her story, what God did for her in her life, in her own words. I was the one that night that needed to hear it. So let me challenge you to do the same thing. Tell your story in your words, what God did for you. There is someone that needs to hear it. Sometimes people don't need to hear what God can do for someone. They need to hear what God did for you. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to ask that whoever wants to be first, I'm going to ask that you come up. This candle represents Jesus.
Those of you that don't know me, my name is Taylor Patterson. This isn't my home church, but this is where I'm able to come on Wednesday nights, because my home church is a little bit of a drive from where I live. But I was sitting here thinking as she was talking, and in 6 days, on March the 13th, I will have been baptized for 9 years. In 9 years' time, there's been a lot that's went on in my life. I've lost my father. I've lost 2 uncles. Past year of my life has been really rough. I went through a lot, and I thought that I knew God. I thought that I had everything in my life straightened out the way it was supposed to be. And then God put me down on my knees. He brought me down someplace where I could realize that I wasn't walking as close as I needed to Him. Brought me to the point where I almost died at one point in time in October. And when I hit that point, and I'm laying there, and I thought that I was going to die, I said, God, I have nothing in the past 6 months to a year of my life that I can look back on and say, God, I was living for You. And during the time that I was in that point, I began to do a lot of thinking, and I began to do a lot of praying, and I said, God, here I am. I said, whatever You have for me, put me through it. I said, because it's going to come out in the end that it's going to make me a better person. And I've always told people, you know, I'm a Christian, but Christian's just a word. Christian's just a title that you can give to yourself. But now I can say I'm a follower of God, because what He's done in my life, people say, poor you, but you know, I say, God, thank You for what You've let me go through, because it's brought out a better side of me. I can truly say that I love God with all my heart now. Because without Him, I couldn't have made it. And I'm thankful that I can stand up here today and I can say, God, I love You. And God, I'm thankful for what You've put in my life. Lord, even though I don't know what the outcome may be, God, I know that You're going to be there with me. And I'm thankful that
preacher, I don't even remember what he preached on. I don't remember the scripture, but the thing I remember is that he said, if you don't know if you're a Christian, you need to make sure. And I felt God talking to my heart. So, Amy, you don't know if you're a Christian, and you better make sure. So I went to the altar, and I asked the Lord into my heart and to be my Savior and to forgive me of my sins. And, you know, I don't have this big testimony of I was into this and I was, you know, I was drugs and alcohol. I don't have that. But God brought me from sin, just like He does the person that's into drugs, alcohol, whatever you can get into. He brought me from sin. Sin is sin, but no matter what it is. And I was a sinner. And we are all born sinners. And if you don't know Jesus, then you need to get real and get serious. Because you don't know, when you walk out that door, it may be the last time you ever walk out that door. You may not get a chance to ask Jesus to save you from your sins. And it's not to be saved from going to hell, although that's a great benefit. But it's because that He made you. He created you. And He put you here for a reason. And He died on the cross for you. Sent His Son, Jesus, to die on the cross so that we could live with Him forever. So the reason is not to get a ticket out of hell. It's because He loves you. And He loves you more than anybody has ever or ever will or ever could love you. He loves you more than your boyfriend. He loves you more than your parents. It's the greatest love that you will ever know. And He will be there for you when no one else will. When your boyfriend or girlfriend is not there, when your parents are not there for you, Jesus will be there. And all you have to do is ask.
decision in my life of getting back in church and finding Him, because He's always been there. Okay, so I'm really nervous. So for those of you that don't know me, my name is Hope. I'm really nervous, so just bear with me. But I got saved when I was younger. I've always grew up in church. It was just kind of, it's always been like, okay, we're going to church. It was never an option. But lately I've been dealing with the whole spiritual gift thing. And on Sunday, Derek preached about it. And I thought, oh Lord, here we go again. I can't handle this. And because I never thought I had a testimony. Because I've never came from anything bad. And I thought, okay, I have nobody wants to hear what I have to say because it's not that important. But ever since Missy started talking tonight, God's like, okay, Hope, it's your turn. Go for it. And now that I'm standing up here, I'm not as nervous anymore. But God just... tonight, don't worry about people think about you. If you want to get up here, do it. Because once you step out of your chair, it's not that bad. You might not know what your spiritual gift is right now, because I know I've prayed about it forever and I still don't know. But if you just take that leap of faith, and if you just aren't afraid to talk to people, and if you just take that step, it's okay. I've gone to this church since I was in the fourth grade, and me and my family joined this church, and our church family has meant a lot to me, and they've helped me grow a lot. And if you do not have a church home, please bring your family and please come. I just wanted to thank this church and God and my family for everything that He's done for me and everything that my church has done for me. And I love you guys, and I just it's something you can't explain, but I just wanted to come up here tonight and tell you that. So that's all I have to say.
It's not really long, but whenever I was in fifth grade, I was in the hospital.
stand with me very quietly, and we're going to keep the room dark. We're going to close, but here's the deal. These testimonies, that was good. Not only did others need to hear it, but you needed to know that Christ is using you to share His word. Amen. You guys that sat there and said, you know, I want to share my testimony and to see how God has spoken to your heart and moved to move you to come to share a word from Him, that's obedience and it's blessing. And I'm telling you, that's how we grow. That's how we grow to the next level of our spiritual walk. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to close. And you know what? I'm going to be very honest with you. Here's what we're doing. In God's word, when He explains salvation, it says in Romans 10, verse 9, I've shared this with you, that you confess with your mouth that He's Lord, and you believe, not in your head. He doesn't say to believe in your head, but He says to believe in your heart that He died. He got on the cross, and He died for every one of you and me. And 3 days later, He rose. There's so many churches, there's so many student ministries, that's made you walk up in front of people and pray this prayer that's written down or wherever. There's nothing in God's word that says that, but I'm going to tell you what God's word says. You confess with your mouth that He's Lord, and you believe in your heart that He died on the cross. I want you for the next couple of minutes to think about Jesus enduring the cross. I want you to think about He went to the cross and died for us. If this room was the only amount of people in this world, whatever amount, however many here is here tonight, He would have still gone on that cross and died for you and for me. Here's the thing. And I want you to talk to Christ where you're at. You can ask Him to come into your heart. You can tell Him that you believe with your heart that He died a death, and 3 days later He arose. You can sit and talk and distract and do whatever you want to do best. But I encourage you to be quiet for the next couple of minutes, because there may be somebody in front of you or behind you or maybe right beside of you that don't know Christ. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm not going to ask you to come up front. There's nothing in Scripture that says that you have to walk this aisle, but it does say in God's Word, and where people get this is in God's Word, it says that we publicly need to not be ashamed. But here's the thing. Here's where it don't be ashamed of Him. Because Scripture says if we're ashamed of the Father, then He'll be ashamed of us. So here's what I want you to do. Amy Vaughn has got the list back here for the lock-in that you need to sign up, get your shirt size. I'm here. I'm going to be here for the next couple of minutes. We got leaders back in the back. Whomever. You tell me, you tell Amy, you tell somebody.